So friends, we were discussing the efficiency of square threaded screw. What actually is efficiency? It is nothing but output upon input. So we will see how efficiency derivation or how efficiency equation of square threaded screw is derived. Referring to the force diagram that we have used for lifting the load, I'll just show it for revision. So this is the force diagram which we have constructed for lifting the load. The work output actually consists of force into the distance traveled in the direction of force. So this is the work input. What is the work input then? That is force into distance traveled in the direction of force. So first is, this is force is W into L, that is force into distance traveled in the direction of force. Second, force into distance traveled in the direction of force, again input, but here the parameter is P, and distance traveled in the direction of force is pi into dm. So as we have discussed, efficiency is nothing but output upon input. We will simply put these values, that is W into L upon P pi dm. So we will get W by P tan of alpha, that is L upon pi dm is nothing but tan of alpha. Further, P is equals to, rearranging this equation, P is equals to W into tan of pi plus alpha. We know this, that is, this is used for lifting the load. Therefore, efficiency is tan alpha upon tan of phi plus alpha. So from equation 1, that is efficiency equation, we can have some following observations. That is, efficiency of square threaded screw depends upon the helix angle, that is alpha, phi, lead and dm, that is mean diameter of this screw. There are some limitations of equation. First, that is, it is accounting for frictional losses only at the contacting surfaces between the screw and nut and does not account for the collar friction. Now if we see this graph, again from this graph there are some observations. I will just simply highlight few of them. If you see, the curve goes on increasing till 20 degree, increases rapidly up to 20 degree. When efficiency is maximum at alpha between 40 to 45, further efficiency decreases once maximum value is reached. Efficiency rapidly decreases after it is exceeding the 60 degrees. Further also, efficiency decreases as mu increases. Okay, now moving further, we will see from equation, this is, that is efficiency equation, tan of phi, tan alpha plus tan of phi plus alpha. We will simply substitute the values of tan of tan divided tan as sine upon cos values. So if you see this equation, this is rearranged as sine alpha upon cos of alpha tan alpha and sine of phi plus alpha divided by cos of phi plus alpha. So dividing and multiplying by 2, we will get the reduction formulae, that is sine of alpha and cos of alpha. So we will get a final equation. This equation is sine of 2 alpha plus phi minus sine of phi divided by sine of 2 alpha plus phi plus sine of phi. So efficiency is maximum when 2 alpha plus phi is maximum, and maximum value of sine is 1 when the angle is 90. So that we will just speculate this as sine of 2 alpha plus phi is equals to 1, or that is 2 alpha plus phi is equals to 90. So from this we will just conclude that alpha is equals to 45 minus phi by 2. Then using 2 alpha plus phi is equals to 90 in this equation, we will get maximum efficiency as 1 minus sine alpha, sorry, 1 minus sine phi divided by 1 plus sine phi. So this is the maximum efficiency of square threaded screw. There is difference between efficiency and maximum efficiency. This equation is basically designating the maximum efficiency. Student must remember this. efficiencies, maximum efficiencies 1 minus sin alpha upon 1 plus, sorry, 1 minus sin phi divided by 1 plus sin phi. Whereas efficiency is, as we have derived it, efficiency is tan of alpha upon tan of phi plus alpha. Then we will see efficiency of self-locking screw. As we know, for self-locking screw, phi is always greater than or equal to alpha. We will use phi equals to alpha in the efficiency equation for a square threaded screw. So using phi equals to alpha, that is efficiency is equals to tan of phi upon tan of 2 phi. So we know that tan 2 phi or tan 2 theta is nothing but 2 tan theta upon 1 minus tan square theta. We learned this algebraic equation in earlier standards. So substituting this in efficiency equation, we will get tan of phi into bracket 1 minus tan square phi bracket close divided by 2 tan phi. Then efficiency is nothing but efficiency is equals to, further this equation is reduced as efficiency equals to less than or equals to 1 minus 1 by 2 minus tan square phi by 2. That means efficiency of the square threaded screw and self-locking screw is always less than 50%. That is 1 minus 1 by 2 or less than 50%. This derivation is important from examination perspective. Further, we will move on to trapezoidal and Acme threads. There is slight difference between the trapezoidal and Acme threads which we have seen earlier. I will just repeat that. For isometric trapezoidal thread, 2 theta is equals to 30, that is thread angle is 30. For Acme it is 29. For square threads, W is the axial load raised by the screw. For square threads, W is the axial load raised by the screw. W is also the normal force acting on the thread surface, but this is for square threads. For trapezoidal and Acme threads, these two forces are different. Normal force is W divided by cos of theta, as seen from this diagram. Normal force is W divided by cos theta or sec theta. Theta is the angle between this, the angle shown here. Further, the thread angle increases the coefficient of friction. Here mu is taken as mu sec theta. Now for square thread, mu is nothing but coefficient of friction. The same value of mu in case of trapezoidal and Acme threads changes to mu sec theta. Remember this, this is the slight change. And using the terminology which we have defined earlier, that is for lifting and lowering the loads in case of square threads, same we will be using, same process has been adopted, or same process can be adopted for calculating the torque values, that is MT, torque required for lifting the load in case of trapezoidal thread, that is P into dm by 2. The value of P is evaluated as W into bracket mu sec theta plus tan alpha divided by 1 minus mu sec theta tan of alpha. And this value of P is multiplied by the perpendicular distance, that is dm by 2. We will get the torque required for lifting the load. And similarly for lowering the load, the sign of subtraction occurs here, the slight change. The remaining values are same. Efficiency equation is also shown at the basement or base part, that is efficiency of trapezoidal screw, that is W by P tan of alpha. That is tan of alpha 1 minus mu tan of alpha mu plus tan alpha. So again, putting those values, that is corresponding to trapezoidal threads, we will get the efficiency equation. Now we will see the collar friction torque. Collar friction torque basically exists at this section where the cup is placed on the collar. The collar is actually an integral part with the screw and cup. Okay, so here you can observe the inner diameter of collar is denoted as capital D suffix I, and outer diameter of collar is denoted as DO. We can think the collar in the form of a washer kind of thing. So the in top view we will observe this. So DO is the outer diameter, DI is the inner diameter, and DM, capital D suffix M, to avoid confusion, the collar diameters are designated by capital D, whereas the screw diameters are designated by small d. So principle of collar friction, we will see how the collar friction functions basically. The cup remains stationary, the cup is remaining stationary under the action of external load, and the collar, that is integral part with the screw, rotates when the load is being raised or lowered, so that there is a relative motion between the cup and collar at the annular interface, that is from diameter capital DI to DO, that is from inner to outer, from this inner to outer surface, annular interface. This relative motion results in friction called as collar friction. So collar friction torque is denoted by MTC. It is determined by using two theories, that is pressure, uniform pressure and uniform wear theory. We'll see those equations. So as far as uniform wear theory is concerned, the collar friction torque is directly evaluated as MTC is equals to mu CW by 3 into DOQ minus DIQ divided by DO square minus DI square. So according to uniform wear theory, MTC, that is collar friction torque, is designated as mu CW by 4 DO plus DI, where mu C is the coefficient of friction at the collar, DO is the outer diameter of the collar in mm, DI is the inner diameter of the collar in mm, MTC is the collar friction torque, the unit is newtons millimeter. Now uniform pressure theory, as we know, the fundamentals of uniform pressure theory is that this theory is applicable only when the collar surface is new, whereas uniform wear theory is applicable to the collar surface after initial wears, that is when the part becomes old. As the normal force on the collar surface is W, the frictional force over the collar surface is mu C into W, that is the frictional force. It is assumed that the frictional force is concentrated at the mean collar diameter DM, which is acting opposite to the rotation of collar. If you see this, this is the value which is shown as mu CW. So if the collar is rotating clockwise, this force, that is mu C into W, will rotate anti-clockwise. So this is what we need to observe. So collar friction torque, that is MT mu, that is mu CW DM by 2, and DM is nothing but DO plus DI by 2. So MT mu is nothing but mu C into W DO plus DI by 2. So to reduce friction, collar between the cup and screw is replaced by rolling friction. So the overall efficiency, we'll see the overall efficiency of the screw. So the total external torque required to raise the load consists of two factors, that is torque required to overcome the friction at thread surface, obviously, and second, torque required to overcome the friction at collar surface, that is collar friction torque, we can say. So MTT is the total torque which is needed, which is to be evaluated, that is MTT is equals to MT plus MTC, where MTT is the external torque required to raise the load, MT is the torque required to overcome the thread friction at the surface, MTC is the collar friction torque. Referring to the force diagram for lifting load, the output consists of raising the load. Okay, then the work output is nothing but force into distance travelled in the direction of force, that is W into L. Again, the input is nothing but torque applied to the screw, that is MTT, total torque. So So the work input is torque into angle turned through the one rotation, that is MTT into 2 pi. So overall efficiency is efficiency, the symbol for efficiency is suffixed by O, that is output upon input. So W into L upon MTT into 2 pi. So the efficiency of the screw is nothing but W by L 2 pi MTT. Now we'll see further the concept of coefficient of friction mu. Now students, please understand, the coefficient of friction is the only factor on which this whole power screw concept is based. If we are unable to understand the coefficient of friction concept, then it is a bit difficult to design the screw. As we know that there is a self-locking screw, there is a overhauling screw. So these all are dependent on the friction values. If there is less friction, there will be much transfer of motion, much easier transfer of motion, and vice versa. If there is more friction, there is more wear and less transfer of motion. So it is, we need to understand. So coefficient of friction mu is a value which we need to understand. We know what is the definition or fundamentals of mu. Will not go into that details. So mu at the thread surface in case of power screw is depending on two factors, that is workmanship in cutting threads and type of lubricant. Mu is independent of load and rubbing velocity of materials. This rubbing velocity is same as we have learnt in theory of machines, that is rubbing velocity of pin. So mu can be assumed as 0.15 for thread lubricated with mineral oil. This is a standard assumption. Okay, so you can assume as mu is equals to 1.5, but the value of mu varies with material combination. So there is a slight guidelines which is given in standard context. So we can see this material combination and mu. So there are two mu's, starting and running. So soft steel, this is nothing but screw, and cast iron is nut. So the starting value of mu c can be taken as 0.17 and 0.12. Similarly, the combination of hardened steel and cast iron requires 0.5 and 0.09. Similarly, soft steel and bronze, that is 0.10 and 0.08. Hardened steel and bronze will require 0.08 and 0.06. So this is regarding the collar friction, coefficient of friction, and how to assume the value of mu. Then we will see design of nut and screw. Now for designing a screw and nut, we must understand which part is important, whether screw is important or nut is important. From application perspective, both are important, right? But when we say, okay, I want to replace a part, either a screw or nut, so the designer must have a clear idea which part should be replaced. Okay, and this understanding is the key point for success of a design engineer. So here we will see the screw and nut design. So we'll see the material. Screws are generally made of plain carbon steel, that is 30C8, 40C8, 45C8, alloy steels like 40CRL, for example, lead screw of lathe, as it's generally required case hardening. Now, as there is relative motion between the screw and nut, the wear is inevitable, as we know. Material for the nut should be soft and conformable to that of the screw. Wear is always restricted to the softer surface, or it should be rather. So if at all a component is to be replaced, it should be nut, as it is less costly as compared with the screw. So just now at the beginning I discussed why the screw or nut should be replaced. Okay, So bronze, tin bronze, phosphor bronze are the materials used for nut. So in for case of screw and nut assembly, the designer or the mechanical engineer must always remember that the if at all the part is to be replaced, it should be nut and not screw from cost perspective. Frame of the power screw is made of gray cast iron, that is FG grade ferrodal graphite, FG 200. 200 is the ultimate tensile strength as it is cheap and can be given any complex shape, and it also has high compressive strength. Okay. Now if you see this diagram, we will see all the parameters, that is nut, screw, the thread thickness T, nut is shown, DC is the screw core diameter, W is the load, this total torque MTT, we will directly see those relations, that is direct compressive stress, sigma C. Sigma C is direct stress, or compressive stress is nothing but load upon area. Now this area is the load W is applied or sustained by this core diameter here. So W upon pi by 4 dc square. Okay. Then torsional shear stress tau. Tau is equals to 16 mt upon pi dc cube. Tau is nothing but torsional shear stress when the screw is into rotation. So we have considered here total torque, or total torque required to overcome the friction torque. Overcome. Then moving further, the principal shear stress, that is tau max, is equals to sigma c by 2 square plus tau square. Okay, so moving further, screw tends to shear off the threads at the core diameter under the action of load W. Shear area of one thread is nothing but pi into dc into t. Transverse shear stress in the screw is tau is equals to W divided by pi dc into tz. So you can see this load upon area, nothing but transverse shear stress. So remember this equation, that is W upon pi dc tz. Tau s is transverse shear stress at the root of the screw. Small t is the thread thickness at core diameter. Z is equals to number of threads in engagement with the nut. Total number of threads, that is, that are in contact with the nut or engagement with the nut. Transverse shear stress in the nut is tau n, that is tau n normal, W divided by pi d t z, where d is nominal diameter. The bearing area between the screw and the nut for one thread is pi by 4 d minus dc square. So that is bearing pressure, that is SB is equals to load, that is W upon area into number of threads, that is pi by 4 dc square, d square minus dc square, bracket close, z. Or just taking this 4 denominator to numerator here. So SB is nothing but unit bearing pressure. SB is equals to 4W upon pi d square minus dc square into z. Unit bearing pressure for power screws. Now if you see this table, there is some guideline given by standard references to assume the value in case if it is not given for a designer. Okay. So application, material, that is screw and nut, bearing pressure and rubbing speed. So if we see hand press, in case of hand press, the material for screw and nut is steel and bronze. The bearing pressure can be assumed between S18 to 24, where for low speed. Okay. For screw jack, the combination of material for screw and nut is steel and cast iron. The speed is low speed, less than 2.5 meter per minute. The unit bearing pressure can be assumed as 13 to 17. The screw jack, that is again screw jack for different combination of nut and screw, that is materials steel and bronze, the value can be assumed as 11 to 17 for low speed, less than 3 meter per minute. Okay. Then we will see the hoisting screw. There are again three combinations. The value ranges from 4 to 10. the speed is 6 to 12 medium speed. Then for lead screw, it is high speed, we can say 15 meter per minute. The combination is steel bronze and the bearing pressure is 1 to 1.5. So that's it. You must remember the unit bearing pressure, how it is important.